Well, I can't tell you what a thrill it is for me and for my, I don't want to say old friends, but you're looking now, anticipating the performance of people who graduated from Notre Dame. My year was 57. We have a 1958 and I believe 59 graduate who are about to perform for us. And we have changed a bit. For myself, I'm just so grateful to be recognized. A guy out in the hallway said, "Hey, Murr." I regret Marlo isn't here. First of all, she's heard me speak. And she is about a book tour now, but always enjoys her visit here to her husband's alma mater. And it's thrilling that it's become co-ed, so I'm now able to sleep in the same room with her. One of our leading feminists is watching over all of the efforts here at Notre Dame to provide equal rights for everybody, no matter what gender, what color. And it is very true, Notre Dame is very much in the vanguard of this, and we should all be proud. So many people have made this institution what it is. We stand on the shoulders of so many people, and I believe we are now enjoying, I mean, I brag about it. I tell people, yeah, I graduated from Notre Dame. You? Yeah. But what a wonderful, wonderful reputation we have. And I know we're all working to make sure that it continues that way. Certainly, we have a student body now which is more varied and more different than when I was here. We had, it was an all-boy place. And when the women came, the young women came to our football games on Saturdays, we were all hanging out windows on the dormitory. And I think what we have now is a more mature student body who actually, well, you know, we have to have a girl in the office or in the room during geometry or whatever I think advanced maturity. And some of us have just now come around to be mature. But we were lucky, those of us in theater. We saw girls, live girls, every night at rehearsals. It was truly a wonderful, wonderful experience. It got me through the other tough parts of this place, the challenging curriculum and all the other responsibilities that we had, like getting back to the dorm by 11 o'clock on a weeknight. So what you're about to see are a reprise of some of the performances that we all participated in during those early 50s, late 50s actually, at Washington Hall, from which location we just came. And it was a nostalgic tour to see this wonderful jewel of a building. And I wish it all for you. If you haven't seen Washington Hall, you must go. It is a beauty. And now I am proud to present the people who will be performing for us now. Would the talented performers for today's program kindly enter the stage?
The rain is mainly in the playing. The rain is mainly in the playing. And where does it rain? On the plain, on the plain, and where's the soggy plain? In Spain, in Spain, everybody.
The rain, Spain, 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 in the plain.
I think they've got it. I think they've got it.
Joe, thank you very much. It's a very good opening here, right? As I look at our assembled performers here, I'm reminded of what Jesus said at the Last Supper. If you guys want to get in the picture, you better get on this side of the table. Our first performer is Dave Shanahan. Abe lives in Winnetka, Illinois. Once my very close neighbor. We lived on the same street. He spent his entire career in the brokerage business and now spends most of his time going to the theater. I know that because he comes to New York and I accompany him. We saw 4 plays in 2 days the last time he came, including Prince Igor at the New York Metropolitan Opera. He appeared in 17 Good News in Oklahoma. He and his deceased wife, Diane, have 3 kids and 1 grandchild. Now he spends most of his time going to the theater. Most of us in the ND Theater dreaded going on stage after Dave because his curtain calls stepped on our lines. Here's David now singing, you'll see what I mean. This was a showstopper in the late 50s. Here he is to sing Will Parker's showstopper from Oklahoma. Everything's up to date in Kansas City. David Shannon.
Will Parker was a hayseed ranch hand. He had never been anywhere. And he finally had the chance to go to the big city. And he came back and could not wait to tell everybody about his experience. So here's what he had to say. I got to Kansas City on a Friday. By Saturday, I learned a thing or two. 'Cause up to then I didn't have an idea of what the modern world was coming to. I counted 20 gas buggies going by the cells almost every time I took a walk. And then I put my ear to a bell telephone and a strange woman started in to talk. What next? What next? Gather round. Everything's up to date in Kansas City. They've gone about as far as they could go. They went and built a skyscraper 7 stories high, about as high as a building ought to grow. Everything's up to date in Kansas City. It's better than a magic lantern show. You can turn the radiator on whenever you want some heat. With every kind of comfort, every home is all complete. You can walk to pretties in the rain and never wet your feet. They've gone about as far as they can go. They've gone about as far as they can go. Everything's up to date in Kansas City. They've gone about as far as they can go. They got a big theater, they call a burlicue. For 50 cents you can see a dandy show. One of the gals was fat and pink and pretty. As round above as she was round below. You could swear that she was padded from her shoulder to her heel. But later in the second act, when she began to peel, she proved that everything she had was absolutely real. She went about as far as she could go. She went about as far as she could go.
He has performed in Good News, Carousel, The Boyfriend, Plain and Fancy, Finian's Rainbow, Twelfth Night, and Oklahoma, as well as numerous community theater shows. He's a member of those were the days of old time radio group, performing original scripts for civic organizations. Bob lives in St. Petersburg, Florida. He performed in Carousel, Brigadoon, and Twelfth Night. He enjoyed a career as financial advisor, vice president of Merrill Lynch. He's the son my mother wanted to have. This daring duo will sing the Oklahoma classic performed by George O'Donnell and Dan Farrone 55 years ago. Poor Joe is dead.
Thank you. Bob and I were roommates back here at Notre Dame, and the Poor Judge is Dead was performed by Dan Farrone, who was a wonderful guy. He's now passed on. And George O'Donnell, who was Phil's roommate, did Judd. So I have done Judd at community theaters, but all of a sudden we couldn't find a Curry. So I'm going to do Curry tonight. I don't know why. our good pianist, Andy Schmidt, I talked to him on the phone. He had a key of E, which is the tenor, which is what Curry does, but I'm a baritone. And so he transposed it to a key of C. Then I got my friend Bob, my old roommate, who incidentally, you might have remembered him. He was the sea captain in Twelfth Night. Right? Yeah. I think he had been anyway, let me tell you the scene here that takes place. This is Judd is a mean, ornery fellow. He's sitting out there in the smokehouse. He is about the most disliked person in the territory. And he's out there polishing his gun. And Curly comes in and he starts talking. Judd, why are you so mean? Why are you so bad? And then he kind of says, you know, you might be better off dead. So here's how it kind of goes from there. You know, Judd, people never seem to like you till you're dead. Why, you'd be all laid out in the parlor, decked out in your best suit and your hair slicked back down, and in you have a high starch collar, too.
Maybe any flowers, you think?
Oh, lots of flowers and palms, too, all around your coffin. And people would stand around you, and the men would bare their heads, and the women would sniffle softly. Some would probably faint, the ones that had taken a liking to you when you was alive.
What woman ever took a shine to me?
Oh, lots of women, only they never come out and tell you how they feel listening to that.
Well, I guess that's so.
Yeah, but their shoe would sing loud when the singing started. Sing like their hearts would break. Poor Judd is dead. Poor Judd Fry's dead. He's laying in the coffin now inside. He looks like he's asleep. It's a shame that, I'm sorry. I'm going back to the first one. I'm doing the backwards thing, okay. Poor Judd is dead. Poor Judd Fry is dead. Oh, gather round his coffin, now a cry. He had a heart of gold, and he wasn't very old. Oh, why did such a fella have to die? Poor Judd is dead, poor Judd Fry is dead. He's looking over so peaceful and serene.
And serene.
He's all laid out to rest, with his hands across his chest. His fingernails have never been so clean. Then the preacher didn't say, folks, we're gathered here to moan and groan over our brother Judd Fry, who hung himself up by a rope in the smokehouse. Then there'd be weeping and wailing from some of them women folk. Then he'd say, Jerb was the most misunderstood man in the territory. People used to think he was a mean, ugly fella, and they used to call him a dirty rat and an ugly pig stealer. But the folks that really knowed him know that between them two dirty shirts he always wore, there beat a heart as big as all outdoors.
As big as all outdoors.
Jerb Fry loved his fellow man.
He loved his fellow man.
He loved the birds of the forest and the beasts of the field. He loved the vermin and the mice in the barns. And he treated the rats like equals, which was right. And he loved little children. He loved everything and everybody in the whole world. Only nobody ever knew him because he never let on.
Poor Judd is dead, poor Judd Fry is dead. His friends are weeping wail for miles around.
Miles around.
The daisies in the dell will give out a different smell, because poor Judd is underneath the ground. Poor Judd is dead, our candle lights is dead.
It's a shame that he won't keep, but it's summer and we're running out of ice.
Young girls cater to old men. I gonna do when a girl gets flirty? Starts to talk pretty? What you gonna do? Supposing that she says your cheeks are like cherries, roses are berries, what are you gonna do? Supposing that she says that you're sweeter than cream, and she's gotta have cream or die? What are you gonna do when they talk that way? Spit in their eye? No! I'm just a guy who can't say no. I can't say no.
Paul Willingham, 1959. He lives now in Santa Rosa, California, and he's led a very busy life. He got a mechanical engineering degree at a Navy commission at Notre Dame. As a student, he appeared in The Glass Menagerie and Macbeth. He was disappointed in his unsuccessful audition for the part of Biff in Death of a Salesman, for which I am personally grateful. He was a drummer in the orchestra for Good News and Gene Bernsini's letterman. His work career spanned 50 years, principally as a naval officer and an attorney. He is president of the World Affairs Council of Sonoma County, California. He and his wife have 5 children and 2 grandchildren. He will reprise his role as Lennox in Macbeth. And it was in Macbeth that Merrily Young Hankin played Lady Macbeth. And Merrily is with us today. Wave up. Way back here, Merrily. Paul Willingham as Lennox in Macbeth.
Just to set the stage for the speech that follows, before this speech, Macbeth, played by Michael Kennedy, at the urging of his ambitious wife, Lady Macbeth, hauntingly played by Merrily Young, has murdered the gracious King Duncan of Scotland and has procured the murder of Duncan's 2 bodyguards, as well as his former best friend, Lord Banquo, during an evening stroll with his son, Fleance. Lord Lennox has survived by being very circumspect up to this point. But now he decides to share his thoughts with another lord and with you, the audience. My former speeches have but hit your thoughts, which can interpret further. Only I say things have been strangely born. The gracious Duncan was pitied of Macbeth Mary. He was dead. And the right valiant Banquo walked too late. Whom you may say, if it please you, Fleance killed, for Fleance fled. Men must not walk too late. Who cannot want the thought how monstrous it was for Malcolm and for Donalbane to kill their gracious father? Damned fact! How it did grieve Macbeth? Did he not straight in pious rage the 2 delinquents tear that were the slaves of drink and thralls of sleep? Was not that nobly done? Aye, and wisely too, for 'twould have angered any heart alive to hear the men deny it. So that I say, he has borne all things well. And I think that had he Duncan's sons under his key, and simply said he shall not, they would find what's were to kill a father. So should Fleance. But peace, for I hear that for failing his presence at the tyrant's feast and broad words, Macbeth, Macduff lives in fear. And Malcolm, methinks, will soon become the bane of Macbeth's existence and then thane of Washington Hall. I think.
Father Gene Gorski, CSC, a 1953 graduate of our university, He has a PhD in finance, master's in music theology, master's in music theory and theology, and a doctorate in theology from the Catholic Institute of Paris, France. Father Jean appeared in The Ladies Not for Burning, Kiss Me Kate, Cyrano de Bergerac, and Detective Story. I know something about Cyrano de Bergerac because I played Lebray. Lebray is Cyrano's friend. And Jean and I would be center stage, and he would be with the regalia, I mean, the feather and the hat. I, of course, had a kind of a, I dressed down for this. My outfit blended into the stage floor. And I would say, "But Cyrano." And he would do three pages. And I got a cramp just waiting for this. Over 50 years, he has served as rector of residence halls here, director of the ND program in Angers, France, and vice president of student affairs at King's College in Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. What a wonderful, wonderful career. The arc of his life is truly remarkable. One of the great university theater performances. And by the way, I mean, you haven't been on the stage if you've never performed the role of Cyrano, one of the most challenging in the history of the stage, and required a lot of athleticism too. I'm sorry to be talking about this, but I was there and I saw it. I was right up front. The duel scene, he carried off, I mean, like a professional athlete, he was out there with the swords, man. And it was real. And during one performance, we were center stage, and he's going like mad. And he came over to me and he said, "How's it look?" And I looked at him, and the opponent, the man with whom he was dueling, got him right in the nose. With, you could see the imprint of the sword in the putty. And he, you know, he said, he's with his back to the audience, he said, "Is it straight? Is it straight?" I said, "Yeah, it's you know, Cyrano." And we adjusted it, and I don't think the audience ever knew. But that's, I'll tell you what, it was as real as you can possibly imagine. One of the great university theater performances was turned in by Jean and Cyrano. And here he is to give us now the nose speech.
Monologues given to Cyrano in the play which bears his name, the action of which is 1640. But first, to set the context, some brief remarks about Cyrano's personality and character. Cyrano in the play is never presented in a bad or unflattering way, quite on the contrary. Cyrano is an aristocrat, a man of noble birth. He is courageous, an officer, and a fighter in the French army. He is brash, strong-willed, a man of many talents. He is intelligent, witty, and eloquent. A gifted poet, a man of letters, a musician, and a philosopher. He is a lover of beauty. He is a lover of Roxane, a distant cousin. Throughout the play, he acts according to his uncompromising sense of high ideals and moral values. He remains steadfast in his pursuit to be a man everyone would like to be. In public, Cyrano appears heroic, possessed of an extraordinary wit and dazzling array of skills. But his private self is dark and despondent. This is the result of his lack of self-confidence and his low self-esteem due mainly to his appearance, to his very large nose. However, the few flaws of Cyrano do not blemish his image. Rather, they appear so fundamental to the human condition that they evoke an even deeper appreciation of his character. Now, we move on to the first monologue. In Act One of the play, Cyrano, with his unusually large nose, has just bullied a blustering actor off the stage in a popular theater. The audience is very upset with Cyrano for doing this, and a wealthy nobleman wants to put Cyrano in his place. So he makes an insulting reference to Cyrano's nose. Cyrano is, of course, unimpressed with this insult, and in the following monologue, he provides examples of far wittier insults, much to the delight of his audience. So the nobleman stands up and declares, your nose is rather large. Cyrano responds, is that all? No, young sir, you are too simple. Why, you might have said, a great many things. Mon Dieu, why waste your opportunity? For example, thus. Aggressive. Aye, sir, if that nose were mine, I'd have it amputated on the spot. Friendly. How do you drink with such a nose? You ought to have a cup made specially. Descriptive. Tis a rock, a crag, a cape. A cape? Say rather a peninsula. Inquisitive. What is that receptacle? A razor case? Or a portfolio? Kindly. Ah, do you love a little bird so much that when they come to sing to you, you give them this to perch on? Insolent. Sir, when you smoke, the neighbors must suppose your chimney is on fire. Cautious. Take care. A weight like that might make you top heavy. Pedantic. Does not Aristophanes mention a mythological monster called Hippo Campel Elephanto Camelos? Surely we have here the original. Familiar. Well, torchlight. Hang your hat over that chandelier. It hurts my eyes. Eloquent. When it blows, the typhoons howl and the clouds darken. Dramatic. When it bleeds, the Red Sea. What a sign for some perfumer. Simple. When do they unveil the monument? Rustic. Hey, what? Call that a nose? No, I be no fool. I couldn't think I be that there's a blue cucumber. Practical. Why not a lottery with this for the grand prize? Or parodying Faustus in the play, was this the nose that launched 1,000 ships? These, my dear sir, are the things you might have said had you some tinge of letters or of wit to color your discourse. But wit, not so. You never had an atom, and of letters, you need but 3 to write you down, an A-S-S. Moreover, if you had the invention before here, these folks here to make a jest of me, be sure you would not then articulate the 20th part of half a syllable of the beginning. For I say these things lightly enough, myself, about myself, but I allow no one else to utter them. And so the no speech. Cyrano de Bergerac.
Gene, Father Gene Gorski. Barbara Bedford Traficanda is a 1959 graduate of St. Mary's College. She married Jerry Traficanda, a 57 graduate and one of my classmates. They live in San Clemente, California. Barbara appeared in Carousel and Rigadoon at St. Mary's College, Good News, Oklahoma, and The Boyfriend here at ND. She and Jerry have six kids. We are prolific because of this Notre Dame group. And our grandparents 21 times, and great-grandparents once so far. Amidst all that maternity, Barbara worked for a CPA and oil company for 15 years. Jim Cooney is a graduate of our beloved alma mater in 1959. Jim lives in Albuquerque, and he happens to be, through no fault of his own, my ex-brother-in-law. Yes, it's true. Jim's sister is the mother of my five children. So he knows me more than he ever wanted to. He is a former development director and executive director of the ND Alumni Association. He met Ann Rohde of St. Mary's, who graduated in 1952, met her in the musical Oklahoma. And they were married at ND. They have six children, we're not surprised, and nine grandkids. He founded a public relations firm in Albuquerque, and also has a video production firm also in Albuquerque, where he now lives. Barbara and Jim will reprise their duet from The Boyfriend, Never Too Late to Fall in Love.
Modern artists of today may paint their pictures especially at a time like this.
And it's never too late to fall in love. Oh, yo, oh, yo, oh, yo!
It's never too late for fun and larks. A jolly old flame has lots of sparks.
And it's never too late to fall in love.
Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear.
The modern buildings that you see are often most alarming.
But I'm sure you'll agree a ruin can be charming.
Oh, wow. It's never too late to be a ball.
Experience counts a lot, you know.
It's never too late to fall in.
It's never too late to fall in.
It's never too late to fall in.
Rudy Hornish graduated from our school in 1959. He resides now in Pacific Palisades, California. He was a theater major at Notre Dame's Communications Arts Department. He appeared in many musicals and plays here at ND and at St. Mary's. As a student, Rudy lived on the second floor of Washington Hall. So that qualifies him as a ghost. He is fully qualified to share his reminiscences about the ghost of Washington Hall. Rudy Hornish.
Hi, everybody. I am one of the ghosts. I look alive, but that can be misleading. We are the future ghosts of Washington Hall. Today, we had the pleasure, as Phil mentioned, of going over to Washington Hall, taking a trip down memory lane. It was fascinating. It is a beautiful, wonderful building. I encourage you all to visit. When this reunion, the FTT reunion, was coming up, which, by the way, coincided with my 55th reunion, which is this weekend, hard to imagine, hard to believe, but I was speaking with Jim, and I said, oh, you know, Dan Ferrone should be there, and Jerry Roderick should be there, and Joe McCardle, and I realized that there were a number of our pals who were no longer with us, and I said, we should put something together to memorialize them so we can, in fact, bring them together with us today for this event. And so Jim, who is a genius videographer, producer type person, started putting something together. We all contributed, everybody pitched in. We found names, pictures of people who have gone to a better place, we hope and presume. I was going to tell you some stories, but I think we've had a lot of those today about Washington Hall. But I think one of the things that I think is wonderful about our experiences here is that we had no shame. We thought we were the best. We had the greatest time, and I think some of you who are here today probably remember after you hear our names who we are. I think it's almost time for us to take a look at that, but I will tell you one quick story. Wandering around Washington Hall, one of the great things about living in Washington Hall, which Dave Shanahan did, George O'Donnell did, Dan Ferrone did, Jerry Dodge did, and I did, and Dick Cavanaugh after me, was you had the keys to the kingdom. There was no parietal hours. We lived by ourselves without a shower. We had a sink, and occasionally you would run over to a dorm for a shower if you could. You had the opportunity to go out on the stage and act to absolutely nobody at midnight, and which was very much appreciated by that audience. And I remembered one story. In addition to those jobs of making sure the doors were locked, and making sure that nothing bad happened over there, they had guest appearances from great artists who would come to visit the university. And Andre Segovia was coming to do a concert at Washington Hall stage, great guitarist. And we were all very excited. He arrived, and he walked in with his manager, and I greeted them and took them to the stage, and he said, okay, the chair is fine. And then he came off the stage, and the manager said he would need a stool for his foot, and it must be the exact height of a New York Manhattan telephone director. At which point I called Gil Rathman, who was the tech director and professor, and we spent the rest of the afternoon on the phone and then building a 6-inch bench for Mr. Segovia. Okay, we cut to later on, the bench is there, the chair is there, Mr. Segovia arrives, he walks out, the house is filled. He walks out, he sits down, the applause dies down, he starts to play. And within 30 seconds, he stops playing. And he gets up in the middle of the piece and walks off the stage. I'm standing in the wings. And he says, it is the most disrespectful thing to be talking and playing with the program while the artist is performing, and walks away and leaves. And I didn't have no idea what to do. I stood on the backstage area thinking, I have no idea what to do next. The door reopened, he came back and he said, have you told them? And I said, no. He said, well, I'm not going back out until you do. So I went back out and I said, please do not speak and unwrap your candies and so on while Mr. Segovia is playing. He said, thank you. He walked back on stage and gave the concert. I think he's one of the ghosts who is still parading, in addition to the bats that are infamous over there, and to everybody who has lived there, the real ghosts. So, I am sure, by the way, it occurred to me that we probably have missed some people, despite how hard Jim worked on this and all of us trying to figure out who is no longer with us. But Jim put together a terrific video, and we're going to take a look at it now, and I am sure you'll agree that it is a great piece. Without any further ado, or with further ados, let's take a look at the true ghost of Washington Hall. Thanks.
Don't die.
Thank you.
do want to acknowledge the support of Ted Mandel of the Film, Television, and Theater Department. Stacey Stewart has been very helpful on the FDT staff. And Charles Lamb of the University Archives Office, especially Bruce Harlan and wife, JJ, for their photographic record that we've been able to enjoy over the years. Andy Schmidt, well, I'll tell you what, there's a musician right there. He plays a piano that's larger than the room I had my senior prom in. We were lucky. I'm telling you, in the 1950s, we rehearsed with these young women every day, and they were all impure thoughts. Elizabeth Finneran Kennedy is here. Betsy, stand up for a minute, young woman. Only the mother of 11 children. Pat Wilson Fastidi is here. Pat, stand for us. And you met Marilee Young Hankin before, but you'll stand for us. Marilee, what a star. And also Bill DeSette. Bill A., where are you, young man? There you go. How are you? Thanks also to Jim Cooney, my former brother-in-law, who did such a fabulous job of putting this whole thing together. Jimmy.
Phil Donahue was the man who took over the ship from Captain Queeg in the Kane Mutiny court-martial. And I was the prosecuting attorney, Jack Shalin. The prosecuting attorney had actually recommended to the judge that Barney Greenwald, the defense counsel, be hired to protect Queeg. And so Queeg, of course, as you know, is the ship captain who went bananas in a typhoon, and his first officer invoked a naval regulation that allowed him to take over the ship. It was based on a real story. As the second act opens, there are only two people on stage. The prosecuting attorney is putting his papers together, and the judge comes in and sits on his dais. And at precisely the moment that the curtain opened, a bat came down from the belfry in Washington Hall, which was not unusual, but it seldom happened in a performance. And it dive-bombed the audience. And I said to myself, I hope to God the judge doesn't utter the opening line in the second act, which of course he did. And the line was, where'd you get that bird, Jack? We lost a half of a play on one line. I mean, it was over.
On the back of your program, you should all have one, are the lyrics. So we ask you to join in the cast in the finale, and you'll see it on the screen, and then we'll all get together here with, this is a mixed media experience, and it'll be fun, and we want to hear from you. So kindly roll the videotape.
Circles.
you all very much. You're a very generous audience, and you helped us share some very, very warm and positive